Well, thank you. Yeah, I came really far, just across the parking lot from the Mission House over there tonight. But my wife and I love this subject. It's important to us. It's part of our lives. Just a suggestion for a book, Mud on the Masterpiece. Anybody read that yet? By John Burke. It's about that. The idea is, imagine if you found Mona Lisa in the mud. I mean, here, the most expensive painting in the world. It's right on the cover there. He's got that that masterpiece. And if you find Mona Lisa in the mud, the first thing is going to be shock. What? The most expensive painting in the world's in the mud. So then the next thing is maybe, well, let's get it out of the mud. And then a lot of times what we do next determines whether we understand anything about restoration. Because a lot of times when they say, let's get that mud off of there, let's take a power washer to that painting, and what are you going to do with the most expensive painting in the world? But someone who loves that artwork and someone who loves what it means, it will take a little toothbrush and just very slowly take grain of sand away by one at a time and restore that thing. And so that's what God's done with us, and that's what we see God has called us to be involved in our mission work in Brazil, in the States, is as he brings people across our path, broken and or being restored like we are, to be that brush that can just sometimes just listen and sometimes use our testimony. I was just trying to go through the numbers, but I've been 2 weeks, drug-free, 2 weeks, 5 months, 35 years. So that's good. Woo! I know that it was hard to listen to that, but that's what it's been like. But not problem-free. I've been in the ministry for 30 years, and I'm out of pornography for about 12. So it's not been all perfect. God had a lot to restore in my life as a man, as a husband, as a missionary, as a pastor. And so I'm thankful that God never gave up. This church, while I was here, my wife and I were here giving a workshop called Wounded Healer. Just to even finish what I was saying about the book, that book, Mud on the Masterpiece, there's a chapter in that book that talks about my wife and our story of restoration. So it's under the Wounded Healer chapter. So you can check that out. We gave that workshop called Wounded Healer in November here. I'm sure it's on video on the website here for the church. And at that time, we were just meeting with the church to come back on as missionaries. We had been supported, I think, in 2003, since 2003, from this church as missionaries in Brazil. And then there was a season where we came back, and I met with the pastor, other pastors as well, said, hey, we need some help. We need to go through some restoration. And that was right around 2009, and we went back to the mission field 2011. So this church just came back on board this month as a supporting church again. And that's a great story of how God restores. You know, it's so important to be able to come back to places that used to support us and that understood that we needed a season of restoration. And then God gave us really that about 2.5 years where we were basically just receiving. And then these last 10 years on staff at a church in Brazil where I was able to use my giftedness, my wife as well, but also be under the leadership of another pastor and just kind of grow. It's been amazing. And so to be back here and be now this time as part of the mission staff here of Saylorville, it's good to be back in that reality. Thinking about a little bit of the story, raised in Brazil as a missionary kid since I was 5, one of our teachers, Bud McCord, he doesn't have a lot in English. He's an American missionary, mostly known in Brazil for his permanecer, or his abide teaching. If you ever find anything about Bud McCord, it's worth looking at. He's got The Secrets of the Vine. That's not his book, but that's the idea of the idea of the vine is where he gets a lot of his teaching. But he told us a while back that old people, old men, don't fall for new sins. He says, you know, usually if the hose kinks back in some place, it's bound to kink there again. You know, it's most likely to kink. So if you have one of those kinked hoses, you'll notice that if you start just pulling, and then pretty soon if it kinks, it's usually where it kinked before. And so the idea that our sins of our youth, they end, they like to rise up and comfort us in our loneliness and in our sadness. They say, come here, let me give you a hug. You remember me? You know, that's the sins of our youth. They do that. And as I look back, and it was very important in the season of restoration that started back in 2008 when my wife opened up that she had been involved with another person, and that really just started up. We had already planted three churches, and so here we were trying to look for help. And in the middle of that help, I also was able to find an opportunity to confess a lot of things that I had never said, especially pornography, and we were able to find freedom through that very humiliating situation. God was able to bring us through to find some freedom and give us a ministry we didn't expect, which was to serve other couples, mainly couples in ministry, but serve other couples that then help them not go through what we went through. But as we were going through that, I was encouraged to go back and just remember the highs and lows of your, you know, as far as you can remember. And I remember back growing up as a missionary kid in Brazil, three of those kinked hose moments where the hose doubled over and it went time after time as I grew, it went back to those things. So I remember we had these coconuts that in our backyard, and I wanted to sell the coconuts. I was 8 years old, and my dad's like, well, listen, you can sell, but not to bars. And I said, man, that's a lot of you know, weight on the shoulder of an eight-year-old to have to decide what the other person's going to do with my coconut when I sell them. But, you know, that was the religious group we were with. I mean, that was the kind of thing. You can't sell the coconuts to someone that's going to use it for any kind of alcohol. So I went out in the wheelbarrow full of coconuts. I sold all those coconuts. Came back, how did you do? I just sold the restaurants. Now, even as an eight-year-old, I knew that those were bars that sold the sandwich or something. Then I was calling them a restaurant because that would get me past. So that bending the truth to get through a situation, maybe even for financial, man, that came back a lot of times. A lot of times that kink in the hose. And then I remember about the same season, there's a lady that worked at our house cleaning, and she would roll her own cigarettes. And I was so curious about that. Man, what is that like, man? I'd really like to know what that's like. Smoke that cigarette and stuff. So I could never get her tobacco. So I did get some of the brown, dry coconut leaves. I kind of crumbled it into my own coconut leaf tobacco, and we had a God Simple Plan of Salvation track. I rolled that up into a cigarette. It was about that thick, probably. And I remember lighting that thing on fire, and as I sucked it in, the flame must have gone about that far down my throat. You know, it was a big old flame like that. Oh, man, that kept me off that until I turned 12, where I, you know, got some real cigarettes and then pot and other things that came after that. But the hose kinked there. As I look back, I became that kid who would try any crazy thing at least once. No, it's as long as if I wanted to do it, I was at least crazy enough to try it. And that came back a lot of times during my life. Another thing that happened around that season, just a little bit before, some other missionary kids were staying at our house, and we were taking a nap in the same room. I think I was closer to five or six at this time. So there was a moment there, and we're taking a nap with this other girl. You know, she's, you know, showing me her, and I'm showing her myself. And there's that five-year-old curiosity is happening. And her sister woke up, told my parents, I got a whipping that I never forgot. So much that I didn't forget. I mean, I don't even think I knew exactly what it was all about. But just the venue that my parents were new believers too. I mean, a few years believers, but gone through Bible college and seminary, but they were the first generation believers. My dad didn't have a dad. His mom was a prostitute and had been 11 husbands, so he didn't have anything to base his life on. So he's doing his best. But as he saw his kid involved in something dangerous, it turned into a big spanking. And basically that kind of ingrained into me that, hey, this is something that is very interesting, but you can't tell anybody or bad things will happen. So that came back a lot in my life. So here you got three things, three kinks in the hose that if I was to go through my story, and I'm not going to go through detail right now, but if I often problems with distorting the truth for a financial benefit, problems with sexual, hidden sexual interests, problems with trying any kind of crazy thing once. And so that was not good. Those things have been great if I could have just talked to somebody about those way back. If somebody could just say, Shane, let's just talk about what are the things that you struggle with? What are the things? Man, I would have loved it. But we went into ministry without that. My wife and I both came out of teenage years where I had been involved with drugs and breaking into at least one home. And me and my other missionary kid friends had planned to break into to rob a bank. But I moved out of Brazil, came back to the United States before that happened, but they did. And then one of them went to prison for that. And that Baptist missionary kid ended up dying of an overdose. So those were the kids that I was in my little hub there of missionary kids. And God graciously got me out of that. And so I didn't deserve to get out of that. Sometimes I say, God, why? You know, why were you so faithful to me? And I think it does go back to the fact that I did give my life to the Lord at a very young age there. And so I was a distant son. And that's what we're going to talk about today is, are you an heir? Because God disciplines those that belong to him. And as I look back, all the things I got caught in crazy ways, that just something would happen, I'd get caught. Nobody else got caught, but I did get caught. And it's like God saying, listen, I love you too much to let you keep going down this road. So we're going to talk about that in Galatians chapter 4. Thanks. I really appreciate the opportunity. I don't think I've ever preached through Galatians 4. So I got to take a close look at it. It was a great invitation for me. I love the things that God taught me through this. I'm just going to share them with you. We'll kind of go just a play-by-play right through the verses here. Chapter 4, verse 1, the first question I have for you is, do you live as a slave or as an heir? Because I was a child of God for years, and I lived as a slave. And for many years, I didn't take advantage of what it meant to be an heir. Take a look at here. It says, what I'm saying is that as long as an heir is underage, he is no different from a slave, although he owns the whole estate. That is such a powerful statement there. He's no different than a slave, although he owns the whole estate. What do you think it means to own the whole estate? What do you think it means to be no different than a slave? What I'm saying is that as long as an heir is underage, a good thing is that what I'm saying is somebody talked about that last week, right? Because it's like to start out text saying what I am saying. Well, what was he saying? Well, just whatever somebody said last week, that's what he was saying. And what he's saying in the whole book of Galatians is that these people who have begun a walk by faith have now received teaching from the outside that's questioning the apostleship of Paul, that's questioning the validity of their faith because they're not abiding by the law of the Old Testament. So Paul has to come in, call that anathema, call that a non-gospel, and he has to give some very clear metaphors so that these people, their walk by faith isn't slide back into this living like a slave. So we have a couple questions that we want to figure out today. That first one is, what does it mean to own the whole estate? I remember a pastor, I won't say his name, but I learned a lot from that pastor. My home church actually back in probably about 15 years ago flew me out to Seattle where his main ministry was. And I just spent like 3 days at his house just kind of drinking and teaching from him. He was a musician, a really good musician, and we went fishing. Salmon fishing together. And it was just one of those moments that I learned a lot. My home pastor said, hey, there's some things that you can learn from this guy. Let's just send you out there and you can learn from this guy. Great. One of the things I'll never forget that he said was that Christians, it would change everything if they just understood what it means to be in Christ, what it means to have their identity in Christ, and who we are in Christ. That's what he said. If they would just know what it means, that who we are in Christ, that would change everything about how we fight temptation, how we live as if we weren't. And I just wrote that down. And about 6 months later, when he was caught with a woman in his town, and she texted everybody, I just slept with the pastor, and it was the end of his ministry. That kind of hurt, because I had learned some true things from him. I had learned some things that about the identity in Christ and what and here he fell. And I remember thinking about that, thinking, wow, what is it? I mean, was it even worth going out there and spending that time with him? And I guess what I've understood and what is so powerful about this text is that Paul is desperately speaking to children of God, to a church, and questioning, hey, is my whole work with you going to be in vain? Are you going to go back to what you used to be? Because it can happen. People can go back to living as a slave, even though they already own the whole estate. Going on, verse 2, the heir is subject to guardians and trustees. So the word subject there, hypo, that's the original word, it's under. So it's the idea that, you know, he can't do his own thing. This heir that lives like a slave, he's going to explain what it's like. He can't do his own thing. He needs to have a guardian. He needs to have trustees. I remember when my dad caught me with pot the first time. And it's like, okay, Shane, we're going to either send you to a reform school in Texas. You can stay inside the house for a year, or you can get your bags and go make your own life in Brazil. So I did make my bags. I went to the street corner. I was thinking if we could, I knew where people would take me in on the other side of the country, up, and it'd be like hitchhiking from here to Los Angeles. And I was like, and I remember, you know, stories of people disappearing on the road, milk carton pictures. I'm like, can I make it? So as I'm sitting out there trying to, if I'm going to run away or not, Dad drives by on the motorcycle, says, hey, dinner's served. Are you going to come back? What are you going to do? I'm like, I'm 15. I'm like, okay. They're going to have to send me to the United States someday, and then I'll flip off the church and do my own thing, but I'll go in. I'll go under their rules now. So I went back in the house, and that really, I mean, I didn't have anything to consume. I actually drank cleaning alcohol there that first week, about killed me. And I got into that 1 year of being protected by guardian and trustees because I was not trustworthy. And finally, it came the time that they let me come to the United States. And when I was out from underneath that guardian and trustee, the second day I was up in Minneapolis, came here for my senior year of high school, I was high behind a car driving down one of the main roads there in Minneapolis, kind of trying to imitate that Back to the Future thing, but I had roller skates on instead of a skateboard. And those roller skates were starting to smoke, you know, and the guy driving was another missionary kid who was high. And so I'm beating on the back of the window of his Ford Fiesta saying, stop. I think he thought I was saying, go faster. But God mercifully got me out of that situation. I was just spoke at the church right there in Lindell Avenue last Wednesday. And I was like, hon, I was going down this road with roller skates. What if I saw that right now? What if I saw a 16-year-old at that time going down this craziness with that being? That was me. And so God is so merciful, right? But when you live like a slave, it's when you can't be trusted without, what is a guardian here in the text? The translation is someone who has to walk you through all the daily affairs of the house. Like your schedule, like you wake up, hey, get out of bed. Hey, it's time to go to bed. You know, and sometimes, I don't know if you've been through recovery center, if you've been through that, you'll know that sometimes we get to the state that that's what we need. Because why? Because we're living like a slave and we can't be trusted with our own schedule. And then it goes on, and a trustee, what's that? That's the person who signs for you. So you can't, like, you're not even trusted with signing your own checks. You're not even trusted with signing your own resources. So this guy here, he's saying, you know, that heir who's already the owner of the whole estate, when he's underage, in other words, when he still lives like a slave, he has to have, you know, people coordinating his whole life. And you come out from underneath that, and then sometimes there's no change at all. And so I know that as I look through my journey as a disciple and also as someone who needed to become free in Christ, I know that there was a season that I was underneath my parents' care, and they did their best with rules at home, and they tried to provide the best they could. But I was still living like a slave. That's a mindset. I was still living as if I wasn't free. And so Paul, he says, so also when we were underage, and it's interesting that he uses his own, because he is one like the only people that can say when we were underage, and he's using the Old Testament transition to the New Testament. So he's going to talk about how when Jesus came, the underage, you know, underage belief in what who God is and what he's doing of the law was graduated into now mature sons of God in Christ. He actually experienced that in his own lifetime, right? He was as a young kid, he was in the Old Testament. And then as he got, when he gave his life to the Lord, that was after the resurrection. So he lived both the time, the chronological transition, but he's talking to people who didn't here. He's talking to people in Galatia, and he's saying the comparison that he's making is that when you didn't know Christ, and then you became free and became a son, you were like the underaged Israelites that only believed, only had the law, and now we have Christ. So he's making that comparison. What comparison can we make today? Before you knew Christ and after. And what he's saying is that there are people that already know Christ, but they go back to live as if they didn't. They go back to live as if they're slaves. And they can't be trusted with their schedule. They can't be trusted even with their finance. They can't be trusted with anything because they haven't changed their mindset that I am not a slave. I am the owner of the whole estate. It's all mine in Christ. Everything he has for me, I just need to be willing to live it in freedom. So that's what this text is about. And that's the analogy of the underaged heir who lives like he's a slave. When we were underage, Paul says, we were in slavery under the elemental spiritual forces of the world. And that elemental spiritual forces, and depends on the translation you get, it's translated a little bit different, but basically what it's talking about, how the order of the cosmos. That's what those two words mean. The elemental spiritual forces, it's how the world was made to work. So when we were underage, whether it's the laws of nature or God's law revealed in the Old Testament, protective rules, that's what kept us in the as an underage and as a slave. That's what keeps us. He says, but you know what? He's going to talk about, we have been made heirs. It is not because of the rules of how things you're going to keep us back from being. Now somebody's going to say, hey, did you overspend this month? No, that's good because you only had $20 on a debit card. Well, that doesn't mean that you've learned how to use your finances if you didn't have a chance to overspend. And so what he's saying is that in the underage slave, he is kept under slavery under the elemental spiritual forces. And the direct translation here is that the way that the world was made to work. But grace comes and breaks everything. That's what we're going to see. Grace breaks everything. I remember I used to tell the story. I heard the story that be careful not to, not to sin, because like the bird who broke his wing, it can heal, but it'll never fly like it did before. You ever heard that one? And I used to believe that. I was like, you know what I found out? That's the elemental forces of the way the world was made to work. Grace is a totally different thing. Grace gets a murderer of Christians and makes him into one of the most powerful apostle and voices in the New Testament. He gets a guy who is bumbling, saying the wrong thing at the wrong time and breaking out, you know, with an anger and makes him into the apostle Peter. Grace gets me, a guy who robbed from my parents to buy drugs and entrusts me with kids that have grown up and they love the Lord and they're serving him. How does that happen? It's because when we leave the mentality of living like a slave and we grow up into grace, we find out that we are free to do what God has made us to do, not just to not do what we're being held back from. So going forward in the text, but when the set time had fully come, this is verse 4-7, God sent his son. So God's timing is always perfect. It's perfect in history, and it's perfect in your story. Born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption of sonship. Because you are his sons, God sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. Does the Spirit call out from your heart? What does it say? I remember as I began to, in the ministry in Brazil, we began to go through some spiritual battles. I remember I really wanted to get rid of the pornography because it wasn't something that I liked. That's what sin that is destructive is. It's something that you're attracted to, that old life, but then it kills you because you have the Spirit of God working, living in you. And you're like, God, I remember one time praying, God, help me not do this again. Help me just to be free of this. Like if I'm about to access something that later is going to just be a huge weight on me, please do something, you know, make the electricity go out. So I remember I was praying like that. And then, so it was one of these late nights, and I'm up, usually it was like this. I was studying for a message, and then I start putting the PowerPoint together, going to go get some pictures, whatever, and then suddenly down a rabbit hole, and then I'm messed up in the internet. And I was right about there, about ready to click on something, and my daughter started crying, my like three-year-old daughter started crying. Ah. I was like, oh, there it is, God's helping. So I went over there and put her back to bed, came back and sat down, and I was still gonna click it. And then the wind blew, and the window was open, the window, whatever, the storm windows were open, bang, bang, bang. I had to go and shut the windows. I was like, oh, God help me again. It's working. I prayed. I said, God, thank you. Now, because I was still so obstinate, I still went, and I remember I was the one who did that. Later on, thinking back at that, I was like, you know, and this text talks about it. He says, formerly, just jumping forward to verse 8 through 11, formerly, when you did not know God, you were slaves, and those to those by nature are not gods. Those who by nature are not gods. But now that you know God, or rather, are known by God, how is it that you are turning back to those weak and miserable forces? Do you wish to be enslaved by them all over again? I remember, I think it was about 2012. That's when I broke free from like, at that point, it was about once a year that I was falling into pornography. And I remember because I had a Celebrate Recovery group, and for the last 2 years, there was a moment at that Celebrate Recovery group, and I'm, as a pastor of the church, leading these guys, and those guys, listen, I can't lead anymore. Right. I need to confess that I accessed some pornography this week, and the guys came around me and prayed for me. Okay, so then I opened up with the head pastor and said, okay, Shane, let's go forward. We can make this. When that happened 3 times in 3 years in a row, that last time was 2012, and the pastor, he just said, Shane, when are you going to start taking seriously what God's given you? I mean, there's people that follow your teaching. There's people that get your kids that look up to you. When are you going to start taking seriously? Basically what he was saying, when are you going to stop living like a slave, going back to those elemental forces where you need somebody looking over your shoulder because unless you're going to do something, and start living in the freedom that someone who is the heir of the whole estate has. I remember I started thinking, man, I need that. And God started giving me that. And of course, I used some helps, accountability partner. I used confessing even the temptation rather than the sin. That's good. Say, hey, pray for me. It's hard this week. I almost, but God gave me freedom right there about when my son was turning 12. And he came up to me with his phone and said, Dad, could you keep this for me because I'm starting to have problems with this? And I was like, God, thank you. What would I say to my son if I had no authority? And I only had a couple months of authority when he gave it. I said, God, this is going to help me. I know that from then on, God has continued to move me in this process of not living like a slave, but living like an heir. So I have two questions for you, and they're both in this text. I won't get into the second. You can look at it on your own. It's, who's your daddy? Because that's what it says here. He says, when you live like someone who is a son, it says, God sent his Spirit of his Son into our hearts, and the Spirit calls out, Abba, or Daddy. Abba, Father. So you no longer So you are no longer a slave, but God's child. And since you are his child, God has made you into an heir. Next few verses talks about who's your mama. And that's, I won't get into that tonight, but it talks about the slave woman and talks about this, got my timer there. Talks about the slave woman and who's the child of the slave woman, or are we a child of the free woman? And so that's two questions that this text brought out to me, at least. Who's your daddy? Who's your mama? And the idea, the answer is, am I an heir or a slave? Do I live with the identity as, hey, I'm part of God's family? Or do I still like living as if I wasn't? Lord bless you and keep you as you continue to grow. Pray for me as well.